Hi there, Rita McGrath here. Today's lesson is going to be about the shift from thinking of your competition in terms of the industry that you happen to be located in to the concept of thinking about your competition in terms of arenas. And it's a very timely idea, I think, as we see the most significant competitor you're ever likely to encounter is not even from within your industry. It's from some other industry, making what you do less relevant, less important, less valuable, or otherwise undermining the competitive advantage that you once had. All right, so the core idea here is that when you think about competition, it's probably not what you think of it as. In terms of competition, you could be seeing competition from any number of different places. And the reason this is important is that in traditional strategy, we've thought of competitors as being located within an industry. And in fact, every industry has its own associations, it has its own meetings that you go to, it has its own metrics that you use. And we forget that we made it up. We made up the concept of industry. And back in the day when our organizations were really asset intensive and there was a lot that you had to do in terms of building up infrastructure and putting in place computer systems and all that kind of thing, that maybe industry made a lot of sense. But today, less and less is that the case. So a really interesting different way of thinking about this is beginning with the customer and the customer's job to be done. And that was a concept developed by Clayton Christensen and Tony Ulwick, which basically says, don't think of customers as buying your product or service. Think of them as hiring your product or service to get a job done in your life. And what you find is most of the really powerful brands have a few jobs that they're known for and that they do really, really well. So you can see this is a warehouse type arrangement. This happens to be an inside look at IKEA. What is IKEA known for better than any other organization on the planet? I need to furnish my living space today. I go to IKEA, I fill up my car or truck with flat packed furniture. I take it home and voila, I've got a setup today. Now there's a lot of things it doesn't do, a lot of jobs it doesn't do very well. But for that job, they have built an entire delivery system around it. Another way of thinking about jobs to be done is what are the critical resources that your organization needs in order to thrive? And we're right now at this moment in historical time where we're beginning to see the end of the pandemic, perhaps. And weddings that have been put off or stalled or downsized or postponed are back on the agenda in a big way. So if your target market consists of people from the sort of 22, 23 to 35 year old age group, and that's a pretty prime market for many products and services, guess what? Where they might have three weddings in a year, in the next year or two, they're going to have five weddings, seven weddings, 10 weddings. And the reality is that anything you try to sell those people is going to have to compete with the budget for weddings. So this is a non-trivial problem if your customer is in that segment group. And that's one of the interesting ways of thinking about arena competition as well, which is who else is clamoring for the resources you would like to be able to extract. So let's think about a job to be done and how one industry can actually spill over into another. And I'd like to use the example of teenagers. And if you think about teenagers, what's the job clothing does for teens? Well, you know, it signals who they are. It signals what tribe they belong to, what tribe they don't belong to, what their aspirations are. In other words, for teenagers, clothing has an incredibly important communication job to do. Now, what do teenagers also do? Well, since about 2003, they're all sort of hermetically sealed to their phones. And beginning in about 2003, cameras first became embedded in phones. And so what do teenagers do? Being teenagers, they send pictures to each other. And they want the pictures to look fresh and exciting and instill perhaps a fear of missing out in their friends, right? Do you want to be wearing the same thing over and over again? No, how lame is that? So what this has actually opened up, I believe, is the window for so-called fast fashion. where instead of the traditional fashion companies, which operate on four seasons a year, and you send the designs to Asia and it gets manufactured and you sell all the clothes at the beginning of the season and then you discount everything at the end of the season. That's not what teenagers want. What they want is, I see it this morning, I wear it this afternoon, I throw it away tomorrow. Now, I'm not advocating for this. I don't think this is a great thing, but it is a behavior that consumers have that we can observe. Now, if you get it right, you can enjoy terrific growth. If you get it wrong, it can be part of your decline. And we see this, right, with department stores. I mean, they've been in decline for a lot of reasons for other things, but certainly the fast fashion movement has left them kind of behind. Who's winning? You know, the cheap and cheerful Ross stores, treasure hunt, come in and find it today, buy it now because it might not be here tomorrow. Zara, same thing. So this fast fashion, you know, where 100 years ago we might own 6 garments and wear them 60 times, today that's been reversed. We own 66 garments and wear them 4 or 5 times. And of course, in the pandemic, it's gotten even worse for a lot of players because we've now got sort of the sweatpants forever kind of movement. So a couple of points about jobs to be done that I think are worth reinforcing. I think it's a myth when we run around saying, oh, customers' needs change all the time. Customers' needs actually don't. The way that we fulfill those needs changes quite frequently. And so here's an example from music. And one observer literally says, over time, the jobs for which I hired music have shifted very slowly, while the solutions have been transformative. So the main jobs, why do I listen to music, right? Help me bond with my loved ones. Help me, you know, accompany me in a boring and painful exercise. Allow me to immerse myself, right? But if you think about the technologies used to deliver those jobs, we've gone from vinyl records and compact discs and the old MP3 players all the way through now to everything streaming and on demand. The jobs are consistent. The way that we meet those jobs is changing. And I think that's where some of the opportunities are, because those jobs don't change a lot. So you want to strive to be the best provider of those jobs in the universe. That's your goal. That's what you want to achieve. Jobs to be done was actually a huge factor in the revival of Best Buy. Everybody had given Best Buy up for dead in 2012 because e-commerce was happening and customers were showrooming, right? They were coming into the store, looking at the price on their phone and then going off and ordering online. But Hubert Joly, who became CEO in about 2017, had an insight. And the insight was this: nobody wants a 62-inch television. What we want is a 62-inch television that is on the wall, that's connected to the internet, that has a remote control that my spouse can work out, that has all my subscriptions on it and everything else. In other words, what we want, the job, is the full creation of a theater in our living room. And what he did was he pivoted Best Buy to really trying to address those jobs. And the mission of the company became to help people get the very best out of their technology, not just to sell the technology itself. And it was the seed that really created a phenomenal turnaround at the company. Okay, so let's wrap up with some concluding thoughts. Traditional industry boundaries really blurring. Arenas form around customer jobs to be done. And those jobs are pretty stable, even though different industries might seek to address them. Think of the outcomes customers desire, not the inputs. You may be very interested in the inputs because that's what you do. Customers don't care. You want to think about what they care about. The jobs are stable. The way they get done changes a lot. Look at customers outside in, not inside out. And I would argue this arena thinking can be a very powerful lens for finding new opportunities. So some resources to keep in touch. You can stay in touch with me. My partner, Ron Bowar, and I are doing a fair amount of work with companies trying to sort their way through these new environments. So here's some contacts on our sister website, which is called Valise. There's a deeper dive section where you'll find videos and downloadable resources and forms and all kinds of stuff. So keep in touch. I hope you enjoyed this lesson, and we'll be talking soon.